As we welcome people in here, I actually want you guys to give a one more big round of applause for our three participants. They actually skipped lunch to be here on time and make sure they give you all the knowledge they have. My role in this moderation is very simple. I want to make sure whatever they know, whatever they have gained in their experience, they share with you, but I need your help. So through this panel, what we'll do is we'll run it in three or four segments. I'll have a few questions, we'll introduce them, you know, we'll get the ball rolling. But at the same point, we'll open up the floor. If you have any burning questions, there are certain topics you want to touch in the gig economy, in automation, would love to invite you and get that started. So with that, I would love to start with Raghu. Raghu, if you can introduce yourself very quickly, and then we have a few, you know, one-line questions for you. And after you introduce, we can jump into that.
Hi, everybody. I know it's a tough act to follow after lunch, but I'm a gig worker in the truest sense. Being paratrooped into the panel because my name is not there, and that's what gig is all about. But to give you a very brief background, I've been in this industry, in the BPM industry, for the last 11 plus years, and that's what it is. I've had otherwise a good run in manufacturing, in services, in IT, and in the pharmaceutical industry too.
So Raghu, as we get started, would love for people to know a little bit more about you. What's your present state of mind? And we'll keep it short.
Excited.
Excellent. A talent you would most like to have?
Or ability to count and crunch numbers.
Okay. And the last question, very quick one, would be a career advice that you cherish most.
Keep an open mind and continue to learn.
Awesome, thank you. Rohit, yeah. Similarly, would love for you to, you know, share something about yourself with the audience, and then
sure.
We can go through the three quick questions.
Sure. Hi, I'm Rohit Thakur. I lead human resources for Accenture in India. We are close to, we're over 170,000 employees here. Before Accenture, I've worked with Microsoft, with GE, with Bosch and Lomb. So in fact, as I was preparing for the gig workforce economy, the entire discussion, I realized that I've done about 12 roles in 26 years with six companies. So I can't call myself like a gig worker because I've been employed by them, but they've been nothing short of, I think, exciting bursts of challenges, you know, that I've gone through and I've learned tremendously. And I think I can completely relate to what the world is going through with the entire gig workforce.
Yeah, excellent. What's your state of mind right now?
Right now, focused.
Okay.
And hungry.
And hungry, of course. The talent you would most like to have?
So the talent, I would say the talent I'd like to recruit is Iron Man. You know, I love movies, right? So from my perspective to in this entire technology and the entire digital revolution, we have somebody like Iron Man on the team.
Okay.
Who can navigate through technology, can, and after all, he got Thanos as well in the end.
Sure.
So I think he'll be somebody I would love to have.
Yeah. And a career advice that you cherish?
I learned this when I was in GE, and the career advice then was that do every job like it's your last job.
Okay.
So the intensity of that job, the fact that you want to leave a legacy, you give it all. It doesn't matter how many jobs you do, but that job is your last job, and do it with that intensity.
Awesome. Sudhir.
Yeah, so good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sudhir Nuhu. I am the CDO and Deputy CEO for Xility Global, a company Indo payroll and HCM. So I've done 23 years in this industry, technology role, consulting, and for the recent role as a business heading in on the digital services. It's very excited to be here, and I'm waiting for what Salil want to ask me.
Okay. Your state of mind?
I think, you know, I would say more eager to understand the perspective from the panel members and the audience.
Okay. And a talent you would like to have?
When I did a transition from my technology role to business role, I think most of the time when I attend board meeting,
yeah,
one of the talent I thought, you know, I should be having it is, you know, dancing in this boardroom.
Okay. And a career advice that you cherish?
I think one of them is going to be, if you really want to get a work on a dream job, start loving what you're doing today.
Okay. Thank you. So as we get into this, I would love to get the audience involved. With a show of hands, can you guys share how many of your organizations in the last, let's say, 12 months have hired a gig worker? Okay, I would say that's 10%.
10%, yeah.
How many of you guys have worked as a gig worker yourself? Okay, few hands go up. So I think this session is very important. And the reason I say that is two reasons. Number one, just based on the show of hands, I think there's a lot of, you know, new stuff that we need to tackle as this gig economy comes up. And we can see the experience, people are still getting used to it. People are still, you know, coping up with this, learning the waters and navigating. And the second reason this is important is, in my opinion, gig economy is like an iceberg. You see very little on the top. It seems, yep, there's an iceberg. There are a lot of thorny issues below the water which need to be navigated, from policy to culture to operations. So with that, Sudhir, if you can get us started, how is the gig economy impacting your industry?
So when you say gig economy, see, as an outsourcing business, it has been there for ages. Companies outsource work to another company. But in the recent past, we have seen with the urbanization, digitization, more and more workers are opting for gig economy because the platform allows to do that. Since I'm coming from, you know, HR background, we have seen that quite a lot of people, those who have got a specific skill set, getting into a gig economy because of various factors. One thing is, gig economy allows them to do, you know, more of a, do the work in a flexible way.
Yeah.
And, you know, everywhere is going to be the workspace. You know, there is no need of going to a particular office and then, you know, start connecting from there. So the system allows a lot of flexibility. At the same time, you know, there are a lot of constraints in terms of some of the social issues for a social, you know, the gig economy in terms of their benefit, et cetera. But in the HR industry, we have seen when we start hiring people, when we started mentoring or coaching people, there are more people coming forward and they want to have more independent jobs.
Yeah, yeah. Rohit, your experience?
From my perspective, I mean, leaving the industry aside, I would say the two big shifts. One is the rise of millennials.
Right? Okay. You know,
about 75% of the workforce by 2025 will be millennials who got different aspirations.
Yeah.
Like 9-to-5 job is a good thing, but they have other things as well that they want to do.
Sure.
And the second one, I think with the advent of technology, the kind of startup culture that we have in India, the shortage of skills, I mean, all these elements, I think, lay a very strong ground for more gig workers. One out of every four workers, gig workers globally, are in India.
Wow.
And I believe the Indian, the potential of the Indian gig industry is about $20 billion to over $30 billion by 2030. So the, again, the potential, the aspirations, the ability to make it real and come alive is all turning out to be a good potpourri of where I believe, you know, this is going to be a, it already is and will become an even stronger catalyst for employment as we go forward.
Okay. Okay. And Raghu, would love to hear your perspective and also parse out for the audience and us, you know, the differences between a gig worker versus a contractor versus consultants or outsourcing, right? In your experience, how do you see that spectrum play out?
I think it is still evolving in terms of the understanding of gig, because while the whole world and a lot of the high-skill, high-tech industry is now looking at skill sets which is beyond what is readily available, I think if the way I would look at it is it's evolved over a period of time. What was a badli or a contractor system at one point of time, to moving to high-end technological roles which will require specific skill sets. For example, today, with technology being disrupted so fast and changes coming in so quickly and rapidly, we're finding it difficult to get the right talent. So in one of our units of our organization, there's a particular technology in which we work upon, and increasingly, we don't have anyone working or interested because it's old technology. And there are enough and more people who are making a killing out of that shortage because of technology becoming obsolete. And whatever we try to do in terms of getting them on board, they're not willing. Because like us, there may be two or three other organizations which are working on that technology. And therefore, for us, or the way I understand this, it is even that niche skill,
yeah,
which is no more into for the future, but on skills which are getting forgotten.
Yeah.
In those areas too, gig is thriving and doing very well. So it started off as the old time contracting system,
sure,
consultants, interning, and all of that.
Yeah.
But I think today, increasingly, it is moving up the value chain.
Yeah.
Both on emerging technologies at one end and people who get bored doing the same work over and over again, to people who want to make a big killing out of the skill sets which they've earned, and businesses which still run on those legacy systems.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it could be any one of those which I would look at in terms of how gig can be defined. And going forward, I think the definitions will get more and more blurred. It could be a mass scale requirement for a very short period. Olden days, it was called contracting system.
Sure.
It could be outsourcing. It could be integrating of technologies for a short period. Or it could be some high-end consulting work too. So while there are too many, there are quite a few people who have a purist definition of what gig is, I think it is still evolving in terms of our own understanding,
yeah,
is the way I would put it.
Yeah, and the people that you hire for these, you know, the forgotten skills that you mentioned, or some niches, and there are other organizations that are also looking for that skill set. The reason they don't want to join one organization, is it the money they can demand? Is it the flexibility they're looking for? Is it the schedule they want to set? What in your mind is the primary reason for them to be independent than be part of an organization?
I think it's a combination of all of the above.
Okay.
Ultimately, irrespective of what they look forward to in terms of money or working in high-end technology or whatever,
yeah,
I think we should also understand and know they're finally people.
Yeah.
They're humans. So they look at some sort of clarity or understanding of what they want to do. Reading a recent HBR article on this gig worker, they define the gig worker like a trapeze artist.
Okay.
Because he would or she would like to be right on the top, surveying the world, enthralling, entertaining everybody else, but getting a personal satisfaction at one end that he or she is being accepted, admired, acknowledged for the skills he brings in. Mm. But as an individual, he or she also looks for a safety net.
Mm.
It's not that he or she will just be happy being recognized or saying, wow, he's got that particular skill set. So they also look for a skill set,
yeah,
a safety net. So ultimately, in my view, what they look forward is a thing called place. Two is in terms of routines. Three is in terms of purpose. And four is in terms of people. And it's all an antithesis of what we understand of a millennial or a gig worker is. When we talk of a place, the gig worker looks for an environment in which he or she would like to thrive and make it work. He or she would like that freedom of working at his or her will and her choice, like a pilot in a cockpit. Ultimately, the gig worker is confined to a cockpit, but would like to fly the skies.
Yeah.
So he would like his space. So that place which I talk of is very critical,
yeah,
for a gig worker. Two is in terms of routines. We believe gig workers don't like routines, and they get bored with the ordinary, and would like to try something new every time. But you should, in my view, look at a gig worker who also loves routines, like the trapeze artist, like the gymnast, like anyone who's crazily in love with getting perfections. So they keep practicing. So for all what we talk of, people get bored with routines, unless they perfect that routine, they can't go out and explore.
Yeah.
So that's the second thing which a gig worker would look forward to. Third is in terms of purpose. Ultimately, we, in our own understanding or misconceptions, believe youngsters, gig workers, millennials, what the purpose in life. But I think ultimately, they need to be resilient. They're also charged with not only proving themselves every point of time, but also would like that their work speaks for themselves, for what they do. And the organization or the customers whom they work for also are happy with what they do. So that's the purpose which drives them.
Sure.
One, in terms of what he or she wants to do at Perfect. Two is in terms of providing value to whom they work. And finally, as I said, it's people. They are not lone rangers by any stretch of imagination. They will end up with loneliness epidemic or royal social isolation if we believe that, or if the gig worker believes that he can work in isolation. Ultimately, these are the four things, in my view, we should look at what a gig worker would need to focus, or as individuals or as bosses or organizations, that he or she, in addition to working for cutting-edge technologies or in terms of making pots of money, the four things of place, routines, purpose, and people will play a role in the mindset or the psyche of a gig worker.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's a wonderful, wonderful foundation. So thank you for that. Would love to see if any members in the audience have questions. Would love to take, you know, a couple of questions. Yeah, I see a hand go up. And I think there are mics around.
Straight down.
If you can raise, if you can stand up so the mic runner can come to you.
Person raise the hand.
There we go.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Vivek. I just want to ask everyone on the panel, do you think in the next 10 years, as the gig economy becomes bigger and bigger, the full-time roles will be decomposing?
Can't hear you.
Can you speak up?
Can you speak up?
Hello?
Yeah.
Mic test. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Do you think in the next 10 years when the gig economy is rising, that full-time roles will decompose and disintegrate?
So I think the question was, in the next 10 years, will gig workers be the majority of the economy? Rohit, you want to take that?
I think it'll be a stronger mix than where we are right now. I think the risks of the gig economy as well. The IP risks, there are, I think, fragility of relationship risks, because you can tend to get very transactional as an employer and an employee, and there are risks of the economy also kind of at the first instance kind of, you know, going down if you have, you know, a lot of gig workers. So I think it'll be a good balance. What the balance is, I don't know. I just think it's going to be a much more gig workers than we have now. I think if it's 10 years, I think there'll be far more machines, that'll be like part of the workforce. So I think having the interesting balance of full-time employees, of gig workers, and machines, which I'm sure will be there. I think that's what at least I foresee coming in there. But I don't think it'll be gig workers all over. I really think there's a lot of value in having a balance across across these elements.
Yeah. Any reasons that companies or organizations would shy away from hiring a gig worker, right? Any particular reasons they would like to keep a task with people who are working full-time?
I don't think so. I mean, in my mind, the way it could go is, like I said, for me, the bigger disruption will be machines and humans.
Okay.
Both, machines plus humans. That's, for me, is the bigger disruption. The gig workers, the way I look at gig workers is, it's like the same thing. We had compensation earlier. We had basic and we had HRA and we had, you know, car. We had a very fixed element of compensation like 20 years back. We got flexible benefits coming in afterwards. You know, you could choose what you wanted compensation to be in, you know, once you got your role at CDC. Similarly, I think workforce or manpower planning, will become, or work planning will become more that flexible. You know, in terms of what do you want? Where do you want a permanent person to be? Where do you want a gig worker to be? Where do you want a machine to be? Eventually, it's to get the work done, to stay productive, to stay competitive, and to really grow. And I think there'll be, with the advent of technology, the kind of potential to accelerate this productivity by using the right mix to what suits your industry.
Sure, that's a great point.
What Raghu mentioned about legacy systems, you know, and there's a potential gig worker there as well, is that, hey, organizations are at different levels of maturity in terms of how they are adapting to technology.
That's
right. So yeah. I, as a really high-tech company working with robots today, might say, okay, that particular technology for me is obsolete.
Of course.
But in some other industry sector, in some other company, you know, that is what they are on.
Yeah.
And I could be fired from that company, and I could have a great job working in 10 companies doing that particular thing. So I think there's a lot of potential there, and the opportunity for organizations to pick and choose.
Yeah.
And for the gig worker to kind of, you know, work in many companies is a immense I think it's going to happen very soon.
Okay. So I know Rohit started parsing out, right? I think the answer is more nuanced. Some industries will see the disruption more, others not so much. Anything you would add?
Yeah, so if you really look at, you know, for the last 20 years, you know, the transformation happening in this, the way we work, the way we earn, the way we spend is going to be totally different.
Yeah.
So nowadays, if you look at all the digitization, which is actually triggering one of the main factor for, you know, creating this kind of a so-called gig economy, or a free agent, or maybe an independent contractor with a different definition. Technology is an integral part in driving all these, you know, jobs. And the second, fact here is in terms of, you know, the urbanization which is happening across all these countries, especially India, if you look at. Gig economy is also the major portion is working in the app-based economy, whether, you know, a driver using a Uber applications.
Sure.
People uses food delivery. It's more and more, I think, if you really look at, you know, for the last 20 years, we moved to an app-based economy, which is actually complementing these gig workers and improving their productivity. And one of these, you know, McKinsey study report shows that, you know, all the developed countries, more than, 20 to 30% of the people are working in gig economy, right? It's not only working in gig economy, but if you look at the full-time employees, they also finding it some kind of an additional opportunity for doing independent consulting. You know, they can go and work. So I looked at some of the data when I was in Australia that, you know, there are people working for 4 or 5 companies. So what are the challenges, you know, this is posing as an organization is that, you know, is company prepared to, you know, have a common framework to accommodate gig workers along with the full-time workers. Of course, we are seeing the trend. The research shows that, when the jobs are getting created in the gig economy, there is also a reduction in this, the full-time job or a part-time job. Look at the case of India. You know, we have more informal jobs than formal jobs. 80-90% of the people are still working in the informal sector. Automation, and there are a lot of hype about automation. You know, if you Google it, you can find at least millions of articles about automation.
Mm-hmm.
So the common message there is that, okay, automation is going to steal the job. But the reality is that as and when things are getting automated, which is probably, you know, 20 to 30% of the very manual, repeated level of, you know, automation, of course that, okay, technology allows them to do much more using machine language, artificial intelligence. But while doing automation, I think one of my finding is that, this is also creating a very niche jobs for the gig workers, right? These are all not the complete project or the complete job. We can slice the jobs into tasks, and I can go to an open economy, and I want to hire the right people to get it done. I can give you an example in my company what we are doing. We invested a lot on RPA, automation, artificial intelligence, because end of the day, as a HR technology business, we handle with talent. So for me, technology is an experience. So the expectation from, our client employees is that, you know, the application has to be very, very intuitive. It has to become an experience. And if it has to become an experience, we need to really simplify HR. And the second fact is, you know, digitization.
Sure.
Wherever you go, you know, if you speak to a client, you know, there is a digital roadmap. And some of the companies, the understanding of digitization is very different. I was talking to another client, it's a small company, you know, according to them, digitization means that, they are revamping their website. So there is enough of, opportunity for digitization, which is adding more of value for gig workers. And platform like Upwork in the US, you know, it's kind of a platform where as a gig worker, you can go and you can sell your, you know, skill set. It's more of like, you know, a company to a person, right? So directly connecting with the companies for the right job. But typically, I think, you know, the two things which has come to my mind for gig workers is, if you want to survive, it is very important that, okay, we need to have a continuous learning. Yeah. So if you are not continuously learning, you are competing with the open economy. It is not like a, within your team in like a typical organization or a, you know, your department, but as and when you are getting exposed to a gig economy or you started working, the first challenge is going to be finding the first job through this online platform. The second one is going to be, you know, how you deliver the customer expectation, because you don't have a team, right? So you are going to be your program manager. You're going to be, you know, communicating with the client. You're going to be defining what your pricing looks like.
Yeah.
And these are typically, you know, the challenges that, you know, people are going to face in the gig economy. Of course, and I think, you know, they also need to learn, fail fast to be successful.
Yeah. No, both you and Rohit touched a good point around automation and gig economy. Do you see it as a continuum? Do you see it that, you know, certain tasks are well served to be, you know, maybe outsourced in a small gig-like fashion? And as, you know, people start doing more of them, organizations get smarter, automation catches up, they probably will be automated out to machines. An example, you shared the Uber example, right? Uber is probably the quintessential gig economy example, but also then you think about Tesla and their other cars who are literally trying to figure out how do self-driving cars work. So is that a continuum? Is that the way to think about it maybe? Either of you.
I think from my standpoint, I don't know. From my standpoint, I think as long as the concept of workforce planning, you know, has changed to work planning. When we look at work planning, it's about breaking up work into tasks, like what you just mentioned, right? Tasks. Some tasks can be automated. Some tasks will need humans. I think machines will enhance and augment humans. That's that's what the element is. So I don't think it's a continuum. I think that as you break the work into tasks, if you think of strategy, I mean, like, you know, like classically, one would say, okay, if I'm a CEO of a company, I'm an owner of a company, I'll do the strategy, somebody will do something for me. Now, if you think of consulting, what you mentioned, consulting or experts in certain areas,
right?
I can be a gig worker, I can be a consulting company, I can come in and help the CEO at the highest level.
Yeah.
If you think of operations, or operations, I would say management and maintenance as well, I could be an outsourced company, I could be a gig worker, I could be an internal employee. So I really think it'll depend on the mix. And I come back to my element of the same way we have flexible benefits, we have flexi workforce, and an organization has the ability to pick, you know, whatever they think is right, you know, for them at that stage.
Okay.
So so it could be machines doing something, it could be a gig worker doing something, it could be it could be an actual employee doing something.
Sure. Awesome. Question.
Can the mic be passed there, please?
Right behind you.
Thank you. So, Sudhir, you mentioned that, you know, in Australia you saw some people doing multiple jobs, you know, different companies. And I'm asking, you know, all of you, what happens to the culture, the vision, the values of organizations when the people are coming only for a couple of hours and going back and going to another one and then going to another one? How does that work? I mean, we're investing tons of money, and I'm sure all firms are, to ensure that their culture, their values are taken care of. And this guy comes for 2 hours and goes back. How does that fit in?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. So as every organization, you know, in addition to the R&D spend, the spend more on building the talent, building a culture, then building the next set of, you know, people around, you know, for executing, you know, what the vision is going to be. So in the digital world, especially on the gig economy, the opportunities are borderless, right? So people sitting in India, as you know, they pointed out in the previous discussion that more and more gig workers are from India, they are working for companies in the US. If you go to US, another interesting thing is that, you know, in this digital world, the human beings are not going to be the actual boss. Algorithms are going to be the boss. So if you are a Uber driver, the Uber application, it will really show you that, okay, where the demand is going to be. So it's all connected, and you don't need to necessarily to be in that office in that particular time to work on that. So that's mostly the flexi part of it. But from a cultural standpoint, I do agree that, you know, what the challenges it is going to pose for us an organization is whether you have a policy in place to accommodate, you know, these gig economies, because the people are coming from different background, different countries, different culture, number one. Number two is, so you already have a, you know, your own challenges in building the talent with the current organization. You have a full-time workers, you have a part-time workers, you have contractors. And typically, if you look at, you know, there are 4-5 generation workforce in addition to gig economy. So definitely, this is going to be a slightly complex, how to build, you know, team, talents across all these different segments of labors. But I think coming back to gig workers, you know, this, the critical thing is that you are going to really compete with all of the guys, those who are available in the gig economy. So you are going to be get trained by yourself. You are going to invest money for training by yourself. And you need to have all this, you know, basic infrastructure that are required for connecting remotely and working with different cultures. So that is very, very important things. Of course, communication is also matters. So therefore, India has got a, you know, advantage. There are a lot of work coming in. And in our company, we are also looking at one of the challenges we have seen while automating the job is we are not getting, or very difficult to retain, some of the good talents on developing algorithms. So we are talking to some of the independent contractors, you know, based in Eastern Europe. So they charge, you know, anywhere between, you know, $60 to $100 for creating, you know, a specific task-oriented stuff for a, you know, AL, ML development. But more than culture, what they're looking at is, you know, how this digital app-based economy is helping them to be successful so that they can grow and thrive. And it's all temporary. They come in for 2 hours, they leave, they finish the work, they get a better rating from the customer, they use the rating and go and sell their work.
Raghu, you want to add to this? We were having a discussion backstage.
Yeah, I think it's a very good question in terms of the how you get integrate these people into your regular workforce. Let's, for a moment, assume that for our permanent employees, all our systems are in place. And if that doesn't work for you, it will not work even for the gig worker. Having said that, let's focus a lot more on what the gig worker we need to be doing. First and foremost is we should definitely differentiate that individual from a regular contractor or a consultant who will come for a few, for a specific task and move on. But here, the relationship and the work that is expected out of it is very specialist in nature or specialized in nature. And therefore, our onboarding processes should be absolutely well defined in terms of the induction, orientation, the company values, the philosophy in which we are doing, what we are doing. I think that's rule number one. What we do for a regular employee, I think it has to be nuanced a bit, but we can't let go and saying, oh, he'll just come for 2-3 hours, for 2-3 months, and then move on. And then it'll collapse. The entire opportunity of using a gig worker is lost. I think that's the golden rule number one. Second is in terms of clarity and compensation and benefits. Because this is Uberization of the workforce, actually. And they don't get any of the permanent benefits which an employee would otherwise have got. And therefore, one is in terms of the valuation of the skill sets, which is not readily available. You need to value that at one end. And two, that this person also doesn't get any of the other annualized benefits which a regular employee would. And therefore, our challenge will be twin. It will be a twin challenge. One, in terms of how we compensate that person who's coming in from outside for the, as a gig worker. And two, your regular employees, how do you differentiate? Because a regular employee would believe that I'm a loyal worker, I work 9 to 5, work on shifts. And why is it this person who comes in for 2-3 hours gets paid more? I think, therefore, the education and building awareness of what a gig employment would mean vis-a-vis a permanent employment, I think both needs to be very clearly defined and explained to both the employees. Otherwise, they'll be working at cross purposes. Normally, gig workers would not work on regular routine jobs. So the question of interaction would relatively be lower compared to a contractual workman. But here, I think it's better to keep people informed in terms of the differences that are there. That's the second thing which we need to do. The third thing in terms of integrating the gig worker into our mainstream, what he or she should deliver, is in terms of the shared values and outcomes. That has to be very clearly enumerated. Otherwise, if I'm vain or if I'm very arrogant or proud, I will only go to show my skill set without looking at what the end objective is. So I think a sense of ownership or accountability of what the gig worker should deliver, I think has to be very clearly defined and explained to that individual. And four, gig workers also need to update their skills, their knowledge, their understanding, and all of that. So is there any program or set of interventions which we should be doing so that for the specialist roles, are we helping, enabling that person to move up the value chain as he works on the particular project? It also becomes important. It's not that the gig worker has got all the wisdom in his head and then he's supposed to deliver. So organizations, especially which are in high tech or in domain rich industries, should provide some element of how we can, as a person works on the project or program, what is it we need to be doing differently. I think that's another thing which organizations would need to look at. And the fifth point is that it's not a one-time engagement with gig workers, because the technology which we develop or the program he is working on would require upgrades, would require some maintenance. So your alumni management of this group, you just can't cut off relationship with the gig worker. I think organizations should start looking at it and not look at them as a one-time engagement. And finally, in terms of does the system, does the unit, does the organization have an enabling ecosystem which will want that gig worker to believe that he is part of the whole system and feel justifiably upset or proud with the outcome of what he or she does. I think if we do these three or four or five things, probably it will not take away the risks of what you mentioned. But the fact is, even with your regular employee, you don't do any of this. So ultimately, I think we need to stick to the basics, irrespective of the nature of workmen. It's like an HR professional working in a hardcore manufacturing unit, moving into a services company, moving into a hospital, and moving into an IT company. Each of the skill sets are different, but ultimately they're people. If the foundation is strong, and if we believe that if these boxes are ticked in its truest sense, then I don't see a problem in terms of gig workers contributing to the growth, and they to feel that they're part of that journey, is how I would look at it.
Yeah. I think there was a question at the back, which, can you stand up? Yes, please. Actually, it's at the back. Thank you.
She was very disappointed when you went to the front.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Hagini. I just wanted, the question is specific to the BPM sector and the services industry. Two parts to my question. First is, do we have to relook at our pricing models? Because right now we run at FTE-based pricing. So do we have to start looking at maybe, say, outcome or transaction-based pricing? That's one. And the second is, how are we really going to tackle with people working for multiple organizations and competitors, the data security part, and maybe, say, the conflict of interest as well?
Since you said BPM, probably I'm the person who should answer. Put me on a spot. So I think today billing in the BPM industry is changing. It's no more an FTE model. Increasingly, it's outcome-based pricing that's working. So the billing has already changed from the BPM context. It's just not what we believed it is. In our own organization, more than 30 to 35% has moved away from the FTE-based approach of billing. So I think the modes of payment, the modes of earning revenue has totally changed from what we understand in terms of how we price work, which we do as an industry. Coming to the second point on what you said was conflict of interest, There would be conflict of interest. My colleague in the panel spoke about it doesn't matter whether it is high-end work or routine jobs. I think we are still in the state of evolution. So in my understanding, what or how gig working would work, at least for starters, is one, to have ironclad guarantees in terms of what people can work, share, but that is only limited to a paper, but more a psychological barrier at one end. But two, I think if it is truly niche, I'm sure, in my view, there's a sense of pride. It's like a consultant, right? Look at any of your big four. They advise similar industries across and have ironclad guarantees in terms of what they sign. So while without, probably it'll go through an era of data privacy being breached and all of that, but it will take its time in terms of maturing. But if you say that if you work only with me, you'll get this contract and you don't work with XYZ, I think he or she will still take a walk. Yeah. It's like a big four consulting or any of the consulting organizations, mm-hmm. or even the recruitment agencies. So I think it is an issue. It is a challenge not only for the gig economy, but for all professions, yeah. is the way I would look at it. Yeah. And it'll evolve.
I would love to pick just to add also, like, you know, open source is again becoming a big thing. I mean, if you think of some of the tech companies who have their own platforms, who had their own, who were propagating their own, softwares or elements in the past, they've now, you know, co-collaborated with other, with competition. And so I think a part of it could be this entire element of open source. Part of it is for the credibility of that individual or a group of individuals. To ensure that they keep the IP intact. So I guess it'll whatever find its own, you know, its own place.
Yeah. So Rohit, like on the same point, right? And I know Raghu mentioned companies, consulting companies, and contractors as well. At least in consulting companies, they would put a Chinese firewall between the same people, right? If you're working on, let's say, company A, and company B is a competitor, they would put a Chinese firewall saying the same person cannot serve both. And you have a great vantage point being at Accenture and, you know, GE and Microsoft before. Is there a possibility to create such Chinese walls? Like, how do we solve this? It's a thorny issue.
I think, like I said, one of the risks is IP. I mentioned that upfront when I spoke about the risks of having only gig workers.
Yeah.
But what I mean by whatever will find its own level is that individual or that group of individuals, a group of gig workers, to have the credibility intact, and for organizations to kind of, you know, assess what part will they give to a gig worker.
Yeah.
I mean, they will need to have contracts. Sure. You've got to trust somebody. You know, even today, I mean, what Raghu mentioned about organizations and the big four managing sensitive data, nothing's stopping an employee today from taking that information away as well.
True.
Right?
Yeah.
So I guess how you select, I think that the personal credibility is even higher, for that individual rather than a whole company, right?
And probably so, references live with you
exactly.
as you
so,
work.
So my sense is, yes, as Raghu said, there will be challenges.
Yeah.
IP is going to be a challenge, but I think it will find its place. The company is smart, the individual is smart, they'll figure it out.
Yeah, awesome. So this was an amazing session. And I'm sorry we are out of time, literally. And I know this is a big issue, and I wish we could have gone for another 20, 30 minutes. So my suggestion would be you guys probably will be around.
Yep.
So if people have questions to, you know, grab you, and clearly there is interest. So thank you for participating. And one thing, this was an amazing audience. Like half of the questions I had here were the questions you asked. And that made it way more relevant. So thank you for doing that. With that, I would love to thank our panelists. Thank you for an engaging session, and
thank you
yeah,
thanks so
amazing.
Much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.